I work in Worcester at Clark University, but I live in Western Mass, and the town that I live in is very much like this. But this is just lovely. And I do thank you for coming out in this not so great weather. We weren't sure how it was going to be, but it seemed like it was okay. So I wanted to start out by, well, first of all, I just want to say that I'm completely capable of just talking at, you know, forever. But I'm also completely stoppable. So please feel free to just, you know, interrupt me or say, ask a question or whatever. I'm happy to stop. And since we're a small group, we can really have a discussion about some of these issues. And I'm happy to take any, we can talk about examples from that you want to bring up too. So we can do that for sure. So I wanted to start by just saying a little bit about how I came to be interested in this topic and how I thought to write this book. So actually, when I started my psychology career, I was actually a person who studied infant perception. So I worked on, I worked on the visual clip. I don't know if that means anything to anybody, but what it is is a plexiglass kind of contraption, and the babies go on it, and then it looks like there's a drop. And the question is, do the babies go over the plexiglass or not? And anyway, this interested me very much. And so I went to graduate school to study infant perception and depth perception, things like that. And I got introduced, kind of by accident, to this amazing motivation group at the University of Rochester. And what the people were doing were studying what they called intrinsic motivation. And actually, what I ended up studying and what they study is why people do what they do. If you ask my husband, what does she study? She says, why do people do what they do? It's motivation. And so what they were saying is that people have this energy, this intrinsic motivation, this energy to master challenges, to be competent, to try out new skills. And this is inherent to all of us, and it's this excitement and passion, wanting to meet challenges. And what they were doing was these kind of experiments about, like, what gets in the way of this motivation. So one of the experiments was a very counterintuitive finding. It was about rewards. So what they did was it's mostly college students. They would have college students doing something fun, doing like a puzzle that was really fun. And what they'd do was they have them do the puzzle, and then they'd say, you know what, I'm going to pay you. For every puzzle you do, I'm going to give you $5. In those days, it was a dollar. And so then they would say, oh, great, okay. You know, who wouldn't want to do some more puzzles? They'd do busy doing their puzzles. And then the researchers would say, thank you so much for coming to my experiment. The experiment is over. I'm just going to go out down the hall to get you to get some more papers for you to sign. There's some more puzzles here, or you can read some magazines. And then they went out. And what happens is that after the fact, the people who were paid for doing those puzzles no longer did them. They read the magazines. Whereas the people who weren't paid were much more likely to read, to do the puzzles, to do some more puzzles. And the idea here was that one of the things that is behind this kind of excitement and trying to figure out those puzzles and do whatever it is we do, whether we're learning to knit or whatever, is this feeling that it comes from us. That if you think about the things that you love to do and you do just for fun, a lot of them you would say, do you have to do them? You'd say, no, I want to do them. If somebody made me do them. And that's the way what they were finding with these rewards, that when you get these external pushes for things that you would normally think were fun and interesting, you lose your intrinsic motivation. You lose your own internal motivation. And we need that internal motivation to be competent, to excel at things. So I thought that was really interesting. And I said, so I was going to combine my interest in infancy with this theory. So I was thinking, well, maybe what parents do has an impact on kids' motivation. Maybe we take this intrinsic motivation theory and apply it to parents. So what I did was, and this is from my master's thesis, which is like 100 years ago. what I did was I watched infants and their moms interacting. And we just told the moms, just sit next to your child and play with them, you know, as you would at home. And we gave them a particular toy. It was like a pop-up pals or a shape sorter or something like that. And then we watched how the moms interacted with their children. So some of the moms were very much taking over, and they would say, you know, put that one here, now do this one, now do that one, no, it's wrong, you know, and we're really guiding these babies. They were 1 year olds. And other mothers were sort of sitting there waiting for their babies to, you know, to initiate and start doing the puzzles, and when they needed help, they would step in, but they weren't leading the way, and they were sort of stepping back until the child needed some help. And what we found was in our later studies that when parents who are more controlling and pushing and pressuring, when the children are given an opportunity to solve a problem on their own without their moms, they're like, nah, don't want to do that. Let me see something else in the room. So that did seem to make a difference. So that's where I was. And the interesting thing for me was when I was doing these studies, and I was young, I looked at some of the parents who were, you know, taking the baby's hands and going like this with, you know, to solve a problem, and I said, I would never do that. Why are they doing that? You know, they must have a different theory of motivation than I do. And I was saying I would never do that. And so you can imagine what the punchline is here, that once I had my own kids, I found it wasn't that easy. And I really believe in this intrinsic motivation theory, and I still do. I really believe that people need to feel like the owners of their action. They need to feel autonomous, to feel motivated. But what I found, but this idea that I would never do that was really, you can tell what happened. But the interesting thing was, now I didn't maybe do all of those things, but I felt like doing them. So that's the part that got me interested. So when my kids were younger and you could let them tie their shoes or I could tie them, I'd be in a rush and I'd go, yeah, give it to me. Oh, my time, right. So that's not giving them too much autonomy, right? Or when they're doing their homework, they were done and I'd say, you know, but the teacher's going to think you're not too smart, you know. couldn't you just do a little more? Let me show you how to do it. And you know, sometimes I sat on it, but I felt like doing it. Or in sports, my kids are both big sports people, and you know, I began to have dreams of grandeur. You know, like this is supposed to be fun, but you know, in the back of my head, well, maybe, you know. And I thought again, what's that about with someone who has this theory of autonomy, right? What's that about? You know, things like how they were dressed. So, you know, Rebecca would come downstairs and she would have on a perfectly good out, you know, it matched, but it was her old clothes, or she was going to a party, and I would say, don't you want to wear the green, you know, why do I care whether she wears the green dress or the blue dress, right? So that really interested me. And also feelings of feeling competitive that I really didn't know I would have. You know, I wanted my kids to be invited to all the birthday parties. I wanted them to be the first one invited to all the birthday parties. Or I wanted them to be, if they had a really big milestone moment, like my youngest daughter walked very early, and I really wanted to tell people. So I probably didn't, because I'm over-socialized, and you know, the back of my head says, you know, that's braggy. But I was thinking, now, why do I want people to know that so much? So that those competitive feelings, you're not supposed to feel competitive like that. And so that really interested me a lot. And so so what I concluded from all that, yep, thanks, Sue, is that it's hard to understand these feelings of pressure and these feelings of wanting to make sure everything goes a particular way until you're a parent. That's really specific to your experience as a parent. What I decided to do was to do some research to look at, you know, what makes parents get controlling with their kids and pressuring and pushy, and what, you know, what we can do to remedy that. And then to write this book, the idea was to, you know, write an empathic book. This is an empathic talk, I hope, because I certainly understand those feelings, and as I'm going to say, I think they're completely understandable feelings and good feelings, but to channel those feelings in ways that will facilitate excellence, but don't undermine kids' motivation. So that's the idea. So some of the things that as we started to study study this phenomenon of these feelings of pressure, we learned a few things. One is that these feelings of feeling pressure to have your child excel, or really, really wanting them to stand out and to feeling competitive and all that, are pretty universal. If you looked in the literature for, you know, what makes parents controlling or pushy with their kids, all you would find, well, at the time that I was starting this research, all I would find was they're narcissistic, they're living through their children. You know, now we have the word helicopter parents, which is a nice derogatory term. And really, when you start talking to parents and you allow them to open themselves, virtually everyone says, yeah, you know, not everybody acts on it, but I feel that way. I really want them to excel. I really want them to be the best. I really get upset when I have this feeling that maybe they're not going to measure up, and, you know, it's big. So they're pretty universal, and so I thought we need a theory that's not parent bashing. We need a theory that's not derogatory, and, you know, telling people don't live through your kids, you know, isn't very helpful. We're not living through our kids. We're loving our kids, and it's really different. So I thought we need a different theory for us. The other thing is that it's really fascinated me that we don't talk about this. You know, you're willing to talk to your friends about sex, but you don't say, you know, I was up all last night worrying if, you know, Jenny was going to make the part in play. People just don't do that because you're not supposed to feel that way. You're not supposed to not want Joey to get the part in the play. But we do. We feel that way. So I'd say they're more taboo. These feelings of competition, or talking about them, is more taboo than sex. The other thing is they take you by surprise sometimes. You know, maybe you're, you know, happily going to parent-teacher night, and then all of a sudden you're hearing all the parents talking about the AP courses or the this or the that the kids are doing, and the Kumin and the early reading programs, and you start to just like all of a sudden feel like, oh my God, maybe there's something I should be doing. And the interesting thing for me is, in terms of talking to parents and in terms of my own experience, you don't even know what it is. Like, you know you're doing everything fine, and you know you don't want to do those things, but you're thinking, there must be something I'm missing. I should be doing something to make sure that he does really well, he excels, and I don't even know what it is. And so, you know, the feeling of you're at the parent-teacher conference and the teacher doesn't say anything real positive. One parent told me she just started to cry. You know, just like that takes you by surprise. That was surprising to her. And so I think these feelings do come. They sneak up on you and they take you by surprise. Great, so you're reading my mind now, that's good. So then we coined this term for this feelings of pressure and competition. We coined the term the pressured parents phenomenon. And so let me tell you what we think that is. Well, it has a physical component, the heart pounding, the sweaty palms, the lump in your throat when your children compete or when you're worried about them not measuring up and not doing okay. You know, before you open that SAT, what the SATs are, that feeling of, is it gonna be okay? Many parents who have children who compete in sports told us that they actually feel like they're playing the sport themselves. So when, you know, if your child's a soccer goalie, you actually, when they go this way, you go this way too. I mean, right? Yeah. That's a connection. That's a a very visceral connection. Yeah.
Did you do anything to try and differentiate between you're wanting your kid to excel and being able to brag, but you know you shouldn't, versus wanting them to do as well as they can so that they feel that they fit in with their friends?
Yeah, and you know, I think, you know, this is my take on this, and I don't know, you know, it'd be interesting to see how you all feel about this. I think that for most parents, really what they want is their child to be happy. I mean, that's what I'm saying, that it really is about wanting them to be happy and to do what they want to make them happy. You still get stuck in this phenomenon, even if you're doing it. There is an extreme out there that's, you know, that's pathological. But for the most part, we're talking about people who are saying, because I want them to be happy, and they're not saying, because I want them to be Michael Jordan. Does that help? So it's got this physical component, and then it has a psychological component, this anxiety and worry. again, this feeling that you need to do something, but you don't know what it is. And I actually think that there's a reason it comes off as this, and it's a very biological reason. So, but I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. So you're at parent school night, parent, you know, open house night, and then they're talking about all these things that you have to do, and that it's that gut feeling or that anxiety that sort of hits you. And in the book, I talk about a funny story that wasn't so funny at the time. Oh, I was actually at my high school reunion, and I was talking to an old friend, and she was saying, oh, that I was asking her what she's doing. She said, oh, well, we're going to every state in the country, you know, one by one by one. And I said, oh, that is so fabulous. You know, the kids must really love that. And she said, because I want Johnny to have something to write on his college essay. My child was 11. And I thought, well, that was fun. Okay, fine for her. But then I thought to myself,
why should I do that?
What is Ally going to write a college essay on? You know, she was 12, and I'm thinking, you know, you're like, what is wrong with me? You know, just because she's saying that doesn't mean that, you know, I have to be great. But it's like contagious, right? This feeling that, you should be doing something, and it gets your better judgment, because I think it bypasses your cortex sometimes. It's like, right, it's in the very primitive part of your brain. Again, what I'm trying to talk about later. Okay. So, a lot of times what parents told us too is that these feelings of worry go on long after your child has forgotten all about whatever the issue was. So Kathy, my co-author, tells a story in the book about a morning where her son was riding his bicycle to school, and they're riding together, and they get there, and they had been late that morning, and they couldn't find a nice helmet. So her son had worn this funny, ugly helmet, and the little boy that had been teasing him all year came over and said, "Everyone's laughing at you in that helmet." Like that. And Kathy went over and she took the little boy aside and she said, "That was very mean of you. Don't do that. You shouldn't do that." And of course, her son was mortified that Kathy had stepped in and controlled this situation. He just walked off into school, didn't hear it. She worried the entire day. You know, I probably destroyed his social life, and everyone's going to be laughing at him for this, and I shouldn't do that. I'm a terrible mother, and blah, blah. And when she got home, she said, the first thing she said was, you know, Josh, about this morning, about the helmet, he didn't know what she was talking about. He had completely forgotten. It wasn't a big deal to him. So it goes on for us when it's no biggie for them. The other thing that parents tell us is sometimes these feelings make us do things that we wouldn't normally do. So if you normally, you know, believe in not stepping in and letting your child solve their own problems, sometimes these feelings get us in the stomach, and we end up solving the problem for them, calling up the other mother about the play date. Could we make Johnny come over so that, you know, something like that, or asking for, you know, special preference, or being on the costume committee so your child gets the part, you know, whatever. So we may do things that, taking over sorts of pushy, pressuring things that normally we wouldn't do. The other thing that we find, and people tell us, is that sometimes these feelings of pressure actually morph into anger and rage. And this is sometimes at the extreme. At the non-extreme, it's the feeling that you have, I don't know if you've had this experience, at the awards night at the end of school where, you know, Tommy Walker gets all the awards. I mean, you do want to, he just keeps getting up and, you know, getting the French award, then he gets the English award, and he gets the Spanish award, and you just want to kill him, right? And his parents. So anger. At the extreme, also, you know, we have the stories of the hockey dad who killed the other dad, and, you know, the rage when you're impeding upon my child's progress, kind of thing. There is, I don't know if people saw the story, it was about a year and a half ago. There was, it was a friend in France, a man whose, both of his sons were really good tennis players, good competitive tennis players, and they were at a tournament, and the dad actually put a drug in his opponent, the opponent's Gatorade. The opponent, of course, drank it, and his son won the match. But the thing is, you know this story. The thing is, the the kids were about 18, and the opponent got in his car and drove home and hit a tree and died. So he is actually in jail for manslaughter now. And, you know,
thank God it's just not us here in the U.S.
Exactly, right. And, you know, of course, none of us would go to that extreme, but I think that, you know, the feelings, you could even understand, even if you never understand what he did, of course, you'd never do that, you kind of understand the feeling behind it, that you really wanted so much for his child to reach his dream, something like that. You know, I'm not defending it or anything, but it can morph into rage. It's also contagious. It's on the soccer sidelines. You see the parent yelling, or you see what parents are doing with their kids, and you hear about how, you know, 25 after-school activities, and you think, maybe I should be doing that, even though you know that would be good for your child. And so, and maybe you sign them up, maybe you don't, but it's still that contagious kind of feeling. So one of the questions that you could ask is, well, is this like a new thing, or is this, you know, how come parents are in this place? Have they always been in this place? Well, what I think is that we are in this unbelievable place in terms of competition. In school, there are more tests, there's more standardized tests, there's more hurdles. We test kindergarten students every week, you know, to make sure they're... So there's tests everywhere, there's competition everywhere, there's grading everywhere. There are some critiques of schools saying that schools are less about learning and more about credentialing, you know, getting the points or whatever, getting the scores, and, you know, we have to worry about that. So your child comes home, has been tested all the time, so that they're under a lot of competition. In sports, people have talked about the sports institution now as a failure factory. There's tons of kids who play at the beginning, they get weeded out little by little, and they're always having tryouts. They're having tryouts when they're in first grade, you know, weeding out. So that's around us too. In the arts, trying out for plays, trying out for different courses and things like that. My personal favorite, community service. It's really hard to be able to help anybody now. You have to try out to be a volunteer. My daughter is applying for a summer position. It's a volunteer position. It's full-time. There are 35 spots for 350 applications for 35 spots. So you can't even get a volunteer position. You can't even help people anymore without competing. So, you know, it's really everywhere. I mean, of course, the college race, for various reasons that we did have a blip in terms of the number of kids applying to college, and it has gotten more competitive. But there's also a lot of a ramping up of the literature and branding of colleges, and, you know, that trickles down. You know, I certainly know fourth graders who know where they want to go to college and are trying to go to college. You know, I don't know if you do, but
they know where their parents want them to go.
That's yeah, right. That's and they have that in their heads, and it's a pressure. Yeah, or you could be like mom and say, I would never go where you want to go. That's the other extreme.
Do you look at any geographical issues in terms of different parts of the country?
Well, not really in my research. You know, one of the things that people have asked, well, is this like a high SES kind of thing? And I think it's not, because the pressure on more disadvantaged parents to have their kids get into the magnet program, to get it, you know, to do these things so that they can get a chance. It's the same pressure. You know, it's the same kind of thing. I imagine that it is different in different parts of the country, but I tend to think, though, that it is pretty universal. Yeah. I think also economics plays a role, and it plays a role in it's not in the front of our minds as parents, but it's in the back of our minds as parents. This idea that, you know, the world is not going to necessarily be his oyster when I'm now in the economic times where there's so much worry about jobs and everything. This idea that he's going to have to be even better to just be okay. And, you know, again, it's not in the front of our minds, it's in the back of our minds. I also think that that 9/11 is in the back of our minds, the way the world has changed. We did some of our research before 9/11. I mean, we didn't know 9/11 was was coming. But we had given parents questionnaires about how worried are they about the world that children will inhabit in terms of safety, in terms of opportunity. And then after we gave them the same group of parents, the same, or another group of parents, but the comparable mm-hmm. group of parents, the same questionnaire, and they were much more likely to say, I'm really worried. You know, it's not a safe world out there. You know, the opportunity may not be there, things could be scarce, and that plays a role in this pressured parents phenomenon. Because again, not in the front of your head necessarily, but in the back of your head. So we're really set up here to, by the competition that's out there, and yeah.
Have you been able to segregate?
Sure, no.
Segregate anything out in terms of degree, say, sports versus the, you know, there's a parent that's, I mean, the psycho in Reading that killed a guy at a hockey game, that's extreme. I haven't heard about that happening when somebody's trying out for a play, but.
I'm sure they do.
But I mean, in general,
in
general, have you seen anything to suggest that the degree is greater in sports versus spelling bees versus the arts?
You know, my sense about it is that different parents have different push button areas, kind of the areas that, you know, that their family sort of
legacy works
around, and so everyone has their own area that they get hooked by. So, you know, you're a sports family or a music family, but the music world, my kids are more in the sports world, Kathy's kids are more in the music world, and the competition in the music world is apparently unbelievable. So, I think everybody's got their own area, yeah.
Different needs for value.
Yeah, I mean, I think that with the salaries that the athletes are paid and you know, the press that these athletes are getting, certainly there's a lot of, and the economics, are a lot of people wanting their kids to get scholarships these days, or mm-hmm. I mean, the odds are so small. So, yeah. So we have this setup. This is the theory, see what you think. And then we have our genes. We have in our genes, we are pre-wired, hardwired to protect our kids. Nature does not, there are certain things that are much more biological and some things that are more not biological. Parenting is very biological. Nature did not leave that to chance. We are hardwired to make sure our kids are competitive, that they beat out the other kids for the food, that they don't get eaten by lions and things like that, because our genes were selected for in the environment in which we evolved, which was, you know, hundreds of thousands of years ago, and doesn't respond to the last 100,000 years. So we have the same, right? It's this very slow process. People, well, something that can be confusing. But so we are pre-wired to, when there's a threat to our child, and in the environment in which we were adapted for, it was a lot, and maybe a lion or something, to jump in and take over for them and make sure they are okay. And that made sense, and we have that gene. And what happens, and what is in our theory is that there are, maybe next slide. Did it again? Okay. That our genes are kind of like, are a very sensitive mechanism. In our genes, there's a very sensitive mechanism for when we jump in. It's kind of like a smoke detector that you, a smoke detector is for fires, but if you burn the toast, here comes the toast. If you burn the toast, the smell will set up the smoke detector, and we want that because the cost of having a fire is very high relative to the cost of, you know, turning off the alarm. So whenever I cook, the smoke alarm goes off. But you want that. And we're set up that way too, that if there's a possibility of threat to our children, that they might be in danger, our internal mechanism, that's why you can feel it viscerally in your body, because we have this mechanism that gets us going. And that was good. The problem is that there's too many cues of competition out there, so we're setting it off too much. And a lot of the cues are kind of they're man-made cues, they're not real danger. They're as if kind of danger. Mm-hmm. And so you know, as if your child, it, so sometimes it feels as if your child is going to really, you know, be hurt or suffer or something like that. And we want to prevent that. That's in our genes to jump in and do something about it. And the mechanism through which that happens is love. I mean, that's the feeling. It's just, I don't want anything, you know, I don't want him to feel bad about himself if he doesn't get that part in play. It's just love. That's what nature has given us to make sure that we jump in. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Well,
I was going to say, I think, at least when I think of the safety issue,
yeah.
You were talking about the pre and post 9/11,
right.
But I know that, you know, all of us could probably harken back to our own childhoods, and that there's now such a premium on safety that's not borne out by the statistics at all,
mm-hmm.
and that, you know, to be a good mother, like, wear the badge of honor, I never let my kid out of my sight,
mm-hmm.
when in fact the empirical data suggests just the opposite,
mm-hmm.
that the risk factor has gone down,
mm-hmm.
but because it's so commercialized with the media, so, well, I guess what I'm saying is
that's makes
it's,
sense, though,
it's
yeah.
interesting that I even worry about sort of the competition factor. There's so much packaging of that messaging,
mm-hmm.
that I don't think some of these things are really borne out with real information.
Yeah, that's right. That's a really, really good point. That's a really good point. Mm-hmm. And if we don't, I mean, you certainly don't want your child to be unsafe, but you certainly want to give them a little freedom to. You know, to fail, to try out new things, and yeah, so it can, I think it's part of this phenomenon, so yeah.
Well, I guess what I see is the lack of rigor about a debate about even,
mm-hmm.
like the whole, you know, safety issue is
yes.
so just there, everyone's yeah. like of one mind,
right.
and that there's really no conversation, and I think and there's no conversation about what is the psychic cost to children of all that messaging about the world is so unsafe,
yeah.
that there's a lot of psychic problems.
Yes.
And I think similarly with some of the competition issues, you get some of the same things. What is the psychic cost of feeling like you have to be? We just had a conversation about them taping the musicians at the inauguration, and there was mixed theories. Some people said it was because it was too cold, but one of the articles I read said, because the threat of making a mistake was too high in that situation,
mm-hmm.
and if Yo-Yo Ma isn't good enough
mm-hmm.
to be his real self, then the standard has just become the problem in of itself. So anyway, it's just it's kind of an interesting
yeah,
thing
yeah, very
to
interesting.
Think about.
Yes, definitely, very interesting. So, okay, so that's the theory, that evolution has given us this very sensitive mechanism to, like, we scan the horizon for danger to our children. That's what we're supposed to do. We find all these cues that, oh, there could be trouble here, there could be trouble here. And that gets us going, and we feel like we need to step in or do something. And again, it's just the feeling that you have is just wanting your, just not wanting your child to suffer because you love them. And it's a completely understandable thing, and it's a good thing. It means you love your child, and it just puts you in this tough position as a parent, I think. So one thing that it does to us is it makes us feel bad. Like, you don't want to worry and be up at night and struggle with those feelings because they don't feel very good. The other is a lot of times it makes us push and pressure our kids. So if we're worried that they're not going to make, you know, the play, we're going to push them to study to you know, do all these different things. And the more we push them, the more they don't want to do it, and all of a sudden they don't even want to do the plays anymore. And the interesting thing you were talking about is so true, that when you are have a lot of pressure around you, it takes away from your performance. If you are a tennis player and you're worried, you know, about winning so much, and there's so much pressure on you to win, you're very careful with your stroke and to not hit it out. You just don't play your game. Your hands are tied by this pressure and by this evaluation. It backfires for you. Yeah. So one of the things that I like this little I'm not sure that this degree of competition is entirely healthy. We've studied this in our laboratory. You know, what makes parents get in this place where they're pushing and pressuring? We've done experiments, for example, we'll bring parents and kids into the lab and have them working on a task, like they'll be working on a poem task, writing a poem together. In one of our recent studies, they were writing a quatrain. I don't set hark back to your childhood. It's like a four-line poem with a certain rhyming pattern. And for half of the parents, we said, you know, we're going to be evaluating your child to see if he does well enough later. And for the other half, we didn't say that. We didn't give them this evaluation apprehension. And you can imagine what happened. The parents who were told that their child would be evaluated were solving, writing the poems for them, solving the problems for them, and you know, being very, you know, pressuring to the kids. Who we have a really great tape of a child actually turning his. It's very subtle. He turns his back so that his mom can't see. again, that's not her. That's the condition that we put them in. We put her in. You could sort of blame her, but it was what we did to them. We put this evaluation in their heads and all. The interesting thing too was that then after the parents and the kids were working together, we looked at how the children could write a quatrain on their own, and the children whose parents were very pushy and controlling and writing them for them, they didn't really know how to write a quatrain very well on their own. So, you know, in terms of homework, you know, that's sort of a message for homework, I guess. So we want our kids to excel and to shine, not because we're narcissistic and horrible people, but because we love them and we want only the best for them, and we are, you know, hardwired to jump in, and we're at the mercy of all these cues of competition that make it really hard for us to do what we need, you know, to parent the way we think is right. So if those pushing and pressuring don't, you know, trying to say that's not going to work so well, then the question you might have, well, what makes people motivated? What would you do instead? What gets them going? What creates excellence and the kind of fuels the kind of passion that you do need in this world, I guess, to excel. And that's where I like to say that, you know, the idea of supporting autonomy in this theory and the idea of intrinsic motivation is not to accept mediocrity. It's to help facilitate excellence. So let me tell you where we're coming from here. One answer to the question of what makes people motivated is rewards and behaviorism in the 1950s. There's still behaviorists out there. I know one of them.
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah, sure, of course.
I did read the book. And what we did have comments from is that part of the anxiety comes from the idea of, I mean, obviously it's great to facilitate excellence, but that, you know, our kids are not going to be always excellent, mm-hmm. you know? And so when I read the book, part of the, you know, in part it generated some anxiety in me because I thought, well, why is the goal always excellence? I mean, you know what? My kid isn't excellent.
But isn't it excellence compared to your own sort of incremental path toward wherever you're going? It's not an outside construct.
You didn't think it sounded that way.
I don't know, that's what I'm asking. I mean, that was one of my questions.
That's a great question. I hear what you're saying. I guess the theory, if you're going to see, the theory is that that people will find their passions if they're given some space and some time. It may be now, it may be when he's 25, it may be, you know, when they're given some space to pursue their passions, people do have this intrinsic motivation and they will meet some challenges and everything. And I guess the thing that that I always think is it's just hard to have that faith that, you know, it may not be this, it may be that, and that people will find their own definitions of that. Yeah.
Right. Well, I'm saying my daughter is, you know, she loves dance, but you know, she may never be she's not going to want to go to ballet. You know, that's just
public. Right.
And I actually want, but. I just think the whole concept of, well, we shouldn't be anxious but still strive for excellence. I think it's that whole concept of excellence that.
What you're saying. Yeah, the theory is that you can't make her that anyway.
Yeah.
So you might as well not try.
Yeah.
Only her interest or passion. Maybe she will, and maybe she will do something else.
She still loves it, in spite
that's
of that.
Yeah.
That, you know, she's never going to be the prima ballerina of, you know, the universe. And I think that's okay.
Absolutely, right. Absolutely.
So then what do you do with this excellence concept?
But maybe are you talking about excellence is their potential, the highest potential that you were saying, Deb, that so you, and then you wrestle with, along the same lines of dance, it's the old proverbial piano lessons, like, yeah. When do you stop?
I think it's a confusing word.
But
yeah,
it's personal excellence.
Well, that's personal, yeah, but
her personal excellence may be to be the 37th best dancer in
yeah.
the grade class.
Right, and she's happy with that, right.
I guess when I read the book.
I was going to say I struggle with the dance thing too because my daughter's a dancer, but and she just doesn't have the body type to be a dancer. But I try to get her to see that there's expansion beyond that. You don't have to be the dancer. You can be the costume designer or the set designer or the choreographer. And she can excel at those things if she can't excel.
I'm just using it as an example.
So I guess the reason why we make that differentiation is for is really not about dance and sports and fun things.
But it's whatever it is.
But it's about if it's about school, let's say. Mm-hmm. I mean the idea is not that, you know, your child brings home a D and you say actually, my daughter's tennis instructor, no matter whether she wins or loses, he says dynamite. That's what he says. Did you win? He says dynamite. Did you lose? Did you win? She says no. He said, did you have fun? She says yes. He says dynamite. but you know, your child brings, I guess what we're trying to say is, it's not that your, this theory is not that your child brings home, brings you his homework and it's halfway done and it's messed up and there's eraser marks and you say that's fine, you know, because that's as motivated you are, that you do have some standards for things that you think are important and there's a way that you can do that and still support their autonomy. Mm-hmm. But I guess making the differentiation between, and I'm going to make this differentiation between things that are just fun and exciting and people are doing because they want to, that's where you want to step back and let them do as much or as little as they want and be right behind them, not in front of them. Mm-hmm. Because that's the only way that they will reach heights if they want to. Mm-hmm. And if they don't reach those heights, that's fine. Mm-hmm. And wonderful, because the goal is for them to love it. I mean, the goal is for them to love it, no matter what, because that's the only thing that really matters to either of those things. Mm-hmm. But I guess I have to think about how I say this, because what I don't want people to think is that this is a theory that says, oh, well, parents shouldn't, you know, have any standards and shouldn't, you know, have any goals and shouldn't have, make sure their kids meet certain values and things like that. So that there's got to be a way to do both of those things. So, but I see what you're saying. That's
excellent word. That is.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Very.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
It's last thing I do is I make.
I know.
Well, I see the distinction as it's doing your best versus perfectionism. Because you'll fail at perfectionism, but doing your best, you can't fail at doing your best.
Right. But even, I see what you mean. But I mean, even we tell a story in the book about it's a mom and her daughter, and the daughter is a horseback rider, and she, I don't know, maybe remember this. she's a horseback rider, and she is part of the thing in the stable is that you be in these competitions. And you know, she just looks miserable, and her mom says to her, you don't look like a punch. She said, I'm not. I hate these competitions. She said, well, then don't compete. You know, you're not trying to get better necessarily. You're just enjoying it, and that's wonderful. Mm-hmm. And that's the only, because that's the only, you know, that's what it's really about.
Yeah.
It just seems like the big thing is balance, effort, interest, and ability, innate ability. I mean. This might be making it a broader thing, but I mean, taking it as an example, a very competitive sport is football. But, you know, there's so many people that once they're done with competitive football, whether it's at Pop Warner and they didn't make the high school team, or it's at high school and they didn't make the college team, or they didn't make it to the pros, you look at them when they're 35 and 40 and they're, because they're not doing something that's like a life sport or something like that. So they're a lot of times are pushed into a particular path because you're not going to make a career out of jogging.
Right.
You know, I mean, you can do it out of running, but you can't do it out of jogging. So people don't play sports, you know, there's so much of it is, you know, baseball and football and even soccer is a lesser sport because it doesn't have the same marketability.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I'm like that with tennis. In my family, it's a tennis competition family, and my husband will say to me, well, why don't you take a lesson? I say, I'm not trying to get better. I'm just trying to play. And if you keep making me try to get better, it will also be better playing. That's not fun for me. That's the extreme, where you're actually not trying to get better. And truly, I'm not trying to get better. And no, leave me alone, because I like it. And stand for the things that our kids love, what we want to do is just stand behind them, give them the opportunities, but not push it, and they'll do as whatever, you know. Yeah. But I guess it's for that other point that we say that. But I hear you. Yeah, I think I completely agree with you. Yeah.
It's sort of a catch-22, because if you lay back a little bit and say that that's just their level that they get to versus doing a stretch goal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of where they get to their next level.
Right.
They feel
simple.
Comfortable with that and then you can stretch goal them again.
That's right. That's right.
And
that's the challenge.
Yeah.
And see if maybe some of this speaks to that. How to walk that line. Yeah, that's the challenge. That's the hardest thing.
Our family competes in a disability skiing program. I met this mother whose child is blind, who's brilliant, and all her son wanted to be was a surgeon. And she didn't know how to tell him that he couldn't be, because she felt so guilty that her child had this disability. And we're talking, and I said, well, what did you do? And she goes, well, it was really funny. I let this go on for like 3 years. And one day he's in his doctor's office at Children's Hospital, and he goes, hey, what do you want to do? He said, I want to be a surgeon. And the doctor said, well, you can't, you're blind. And he said, why didn't anybody tell me that? And it was perfect, you know, and she was just so racked with guilt. Oh, if only he wasn't blind, he was so willing to be. And the kid was like, you know what, you're right, that's going to be awesome. And it's one of those moments I take with me, and I go, oh my God, and there's an extreme. But she said, 3 years I walked around encouraging him, do really well in school, work really hard, and she goes, he's getting older.
That's an interesting story.
But then the doctor said, you can't. But let's find something else you can do in medicine and research. Right.
But the difference there is the doctor said it.
Not the mother.
Thank the goodness. Yeah. So that, you know, alleviates a little bit.
Yeah, that's a great story.
Do copy and research.
Yeah. That's a great story. okay, so contrary to this idea, I forget what I'm saying.
So you said you're not a behaviorist, though. You don't believe you're not a...
Well, I certainly believe that if you reward people, they'll do... I mean, if I give you enough money, I can... that rewards increased motivation, but the kind of motivation that we care about, that the kind of motivation that really is going to fuel us to enjoy learning, which is going to make us learn better, or to, you know, to practice our skills at basketball, whatever it is intrinsic motivation, and that's the kind that you undermine with rewards. So can you get people to do things? Absolutely. Can you get them to want to do things? No. You can't get someone to love something. You can't get someone to want to do something. You can just get them to do it, and that's easy. So that's easy. Nobody needs that talk, right? So I guess I'm not a behaviorist in the sense that I believe that people have intrinsic motivation. True behaviorists don't believe in intrinsic motivation. They believe that ultimately everything you do is because of rewards. So it's like a little bit of a different twist on it. Yeah. Yeah.
But one of the things I keep coming back to in my mind, and I know I'm always saying to my children, is how do you get them through? I find that they think they're going to be good at things easily. And I said, nobody's good at it. Most people are not good at most things easily.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so some of this, the real feeling of success is powering through when it's not fun and it's hard. But it's not so they can be the best at it. It's just that's a life skill that I think is really important. And so I really struggle with what messaging I want to give, not that you just have to, you know.
Exactly. So that's exactly right. So half of this, or half of the story, is this intrinsic motivation. Now we have this desire to be competent, to be autonomous, and to take on challenges and all of that. And the thing you would want to do if your child has an interest is just allow them to pursue it and, you know, provide them opportunities and all of that sort of thing. But there's the other part of that. In any endeavor, there's the hard parts of it. And so that's really the, that's the next, oh, okay. So what we're saying is what fuels this intrinsic motivation is we have innate desires to be autonomous. We really do best. We're at our, as adults, as kids, our well-being is best when we're doing what we want to do, what we feel it comes from us, that we're not being coerced. To feel competent, that we feel we're, you know, we can do something. We don't do very well when we feel incompetent as human beings. We're not wired that way. And connected to other people. So our innate desires to feel autonomous, to feel competent, to feel connected, fuel this trying to meet these challenges and so forth. Okay, but as you're saying, that's not the whole story, because there's the rest of everything that we want our kids to do and that we have to do. Like, if you look at adults, this is a sad figure, but about 10% of our time we're spending, 10 to 15% of our time we're spending in purely intrinsically motivated activity, things that we just do because we love to do them. About 10 to 15% of your time. The other times you're doing stuff for other reasons. but the other reasons make a difference, because we talk about this as internalization. You know, you got to study for the SATs. You just have to, right? And you have to do certain things. You have to do the play the chords in order to play the piano. You have to go do the scales up and down and down. Right. So, but there are different kinds of extrinsic motivation. So extrinsic motives are the things that we do for some reason other than it's fun. Oops.
We'll that's okay.
One of the kinds of external motivation is what we call gun to the head or coerced motivation. That's the things that you do because you have to. You would not do them otherwise. Somebody is telling you, you better do it, or you know you're going to get fired, or you know whatever. The teacher's going to get mad at you, or whatever. Then, and if you ask why do you do your homework, you say because I want to be able to go outside. I have to, or else I can't go outside. There's no other reason. A second kind of motivation is what we call interjected or guilty motivation, and that's because you feel bad if you don't. So it's like halfway between. I don't want to do it, but no one else is forcing me. I'm forcing myself. I feel like I have to do it, or I'd be a bad person, or I'd feel guilty, or you know that kind of thing. And then the third kind is what we call identified or agree motivation. It's because I want to, and it's not that it's fun. It doesn't make it fun. But it's just because it helps me to meet my goals. So I want to be, I want to be a good singer, and I want to be a good piano player. So I'm practicing these chords because I can see that it's going to get me where I want to go, and ultimately I'll be able to practice the piano and so forth. So what we want to do is facilitate intrinsic motivation by stepping back and standing behind and not pushing the things that people are having fun doing and wanting to do, and facilitating kids to move for things that are important in the world, like schoolwork or you know multiplication tables or setting the table or cleaning their rooms. We want to help them move from here to here, right? They start out doing it because I have to, you tell them to, but then they begin to do it because they want to, because they have their own goals. They're not your goals anymore, they're their goals. And so the question is, how do you get kids to move along that continuum? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the answer in our theory, is that you want to, one, promote their feelings of autonomy. So to help them to feel that the thing that they're doing, even though it's not fun, is something that is coming from them. And that helps them. You promote feelings of autonomy by supporting their autonomy. We'll talk a little bit about how to do that. And then we promote feelings of competence by providing structure. Kids don't know. They don't know how you get from here to there. They don't know that, you know, how you become a good singer. So you they need information. They need some guidelines. They need to be, to understand. And you have the information, or you gather it together and you figure it out. You know, these are the things to do to get where you want to go. So they need to have that structure in place in order to feel competent. If they don't know how to get from here to there, okay. And then being involved. If there's one kind of variable in the literature that's really clear, is that the parent involvement is wonderful. It's great for kids. there's no study I've ever read that said it isn't. Now we want to, in this theory, we want to do these things at the same time as we're doing this. But involvement, it's not curvilinear, like a little medium levels is good. It's the more the better. It's just when it promotes feelings of autonomy, then it's really going to fuel motivation. So, so there's a lot of, let's talk about the structure, the involvement maybe is the easiest, right? When you have to be involved. You're all involved or you wouldn't be here. Right? And the structure maybe is more straightforward. The autonomy support is the tricky one, I think. But just to give you a little background, there's just tons of research that shows that supporting kids' autonomy is facilitative, or supporting people's autonomy is facilitative of their motivation. So the more teachers support autonomy, the more their students are motivated, the more they feel competent, the more they have high self-esteem. The more physicians support their patients' autonomy by getting their input and problem-solving together rather than telling them what to do all the time, that facilitates patient motivation. We did a study once where we asked people how autonomy supportive their doctors were, and it was actually a group of older patients who had very complicated drug regimens. They just taking a lot of drugs. And then we brought them back later and we counted their meds to see if they were adherent. And the ones whose doctors were more autonomy supportive were actually more adherent to their medications than the ones who had their more directive controlling pushy doctors. So it makes a difference. Coaches, absolutely, the more coaches support kids' autonomy, the more the kids persist and the less they drop out of sport. So it really does, there's a lot of research behind this construct of autonomy, of supporting autonomy. Probably preaching to the choir on this one. Okay, next one. So how do you do that? One thing you want, so if you're trying to get your child to do something that you think is important, we have to get our kids to do, we have to get them to clean their rooms, we have to get them to practice on the piano, we have, you know, all these things. The way you can help your child to feel more autonomous about it is to do these things. One is to take your child's perspective. So if it's something that they don't want to do, it goes a long way to say, geez, I can understand that the last thing you want to be doing on this beautiful day is to be practicing the chords on the piano. And that goes for you and your job, any of us in our jobs as well. Giving choice, figuring out what they want to do first, what they want to do second, how, taking this structure, when we talk about structure, we live within guidelines. There are going to be guidelines of what they can do and what they can't do, but there's always a little leeway in terms of what choice. And when we get to choose, we feel more autonomous. We feel at least we know if your boss tells you this has to be done by Friday, but you can do it tomorrow, you can do it the next day, you can do this one first, you can do this one second, you're like, oh, okay. And you can still feel more autonomous about that. And avoiding controlling language. It's, every once in a while my husband will say to me, he's in a rush, and he says, take out the trash. No, and you're just not used to being talked to like that. And I say, well, there's no way I'm going to do it now. I'm very personally control sensitive. Research is research and everything. So I don't like people controlling. There's just no way now. But you can change that with asking it in a way that that avoids this shoulds, have tos, musts. We talk to kids like that all the time. We say, go do your homework, you better do your homework, you have to do your homework, you should do your homework, you should do this, you should do that. And if you think about it, if somebody said it to you, you better buy one of my books. The last thing you do is, you should buy one of my books. Can you feel it? You just like
right, I will.
No. No. Right. So but kids are sensitive the same way. And so if we are asking them to do something that we want them to do, we can help them to feel more autonomous by doing some of these things. Yeah.
This is really fascinating. I grew up in a very do this, do that, no discussion. Yep. And I think
are you control sensitive?
No. I think sorry. I go so far the other way with my kids. And honestly, what I found is it's unclear to them. Mm-hmm. They want me to say, do this. It's, they want the clarity of knowing this is what, and I think I use a lot of qualifying language, and I really found over a long time it's really not that effective. Simple and direct works better for them.
Great point. Can you do the next slide, Hannah? Because it's really, it's
clear.
Yeah, I think what the issue is having clarity about the structure of what you want, but doing it in an autonomous, supportive way. Mm-hmm. So it's not being autonomous, supportive is not. If the table needs to be set, it's not. Would you like to set the table?
Could you set the table?
Could you set the table?
Say, mom, say you need to set the table.
Yeah,
you know, they said that to me, and it's so strange.
Exactly, because they do want. That's exactly true. Because they do want. They do want it to be clear what's expected of them, and you can do that in a way that is autonomy supportive. So, but we do find in all of our research homes where there's structure, where there's clear rules and expectations, and everybody knows what they're expected to do, and you know, that facilitates motivation too. So what you want to do is to say, if you want the table set, rather than saying, would you like to set the table? It's actually something that that when my students, you know, I teach a child assessment course. And you know, I have the graduate students who are, you know, child-loving people, you know, just child-loving people. And they sit down with the kids and they say, would you like to start? And I say, no, don't, you can't say that. Because they don't have a choice. I mean, don't give a phony choice. If there's no choice, just say, it's time to start. But you don't have to say, you have to start. So it's time to start. That's just the rule. That's just the way it is. If you see they don't look like they want to start, you can say, I can see that you don't really want to be here. You'd rather be doing something else, but it's time to start. That feels like I've been heard, I've been understood, but I understand what is expected of me too. There's no like, right? Because if I have the choice to start or not, then I'm just confused.
Well, it's been a long, confusing road to get to that point.
And what Gnat says is do it in the third person, and it sounds really funny, but if you do it, you say, instead of saying, you can't jump on the couch, that's power, that I'm the powerful one and you're not, you say, couches aren't for jumping on. Like, that's just the way of the world. The world is full of rules and expectations, and that's just one of them. And it's not about you and me, it's about couches. It's about what is good for couches, you know. And then you give them a reason. And the way you do structure in an autonomy support, can I have the next slide? The way you do structure in an autonomy supportive way is you give reasons, you always give reasons. So you can't expect people to go along that internalization continuum and want to do something if they don't have a good reason for it. They have to buy it, they have to value it. Like, oh, the chords will get me to being the same. The reason you play the, this is what you said, giving you the example, and I really, it was music example, right? That you gave?
Setting the table thing. Oh, okay. Well, whatever.
The thing you were talking about before was you have to, in order to be
have to pop your kind of power.
Right, so you have information. In order to get better at the piano, people practice chords, and chords help you to. Chords help you to move your fingers better and get a tune and blah, blah, blah. So, oh, okay, that's information that they didn't have. And if you don't have that information, like you, the only reason you're going to do the chords is because somebody's telling you have to, and that just doesn't do it for you. It's not going to do it for you. Give reasons. The reason that people do these chords is this, right? And then if there are that's that example. The other example that you could give is something that has to be done that is an expectation. It's just right. So you can have setting the table. The reasons why you're asking them to set the table, the empathy about the fact that they don't want to set the table, the consequences for not setting the table if you get to that. Just, you know, if you don't set the table, well then you're not going to be, you don't go outside. It's just the facts. It's just the way it is. You don't have to get mad, you don't have to scream at them. It's just the way the world works. But And if you're talking about setting the table, perhaps at a time when it's not table setting time and you're both calm and you say, well, let's talk about how, you know, which chores do you want to do and how can we set this up so that you feel like you're doing the chores that make sense to you, listen to their opinions rather than saying you have to. And so you can, so it's supporting their autonomy by giving them input, giving them choice, giving them empathy, but not being a pushover, you know, having the rules and expectations really clear. If you want something, you're going to get mad at it. If you want the table set and you don't, and you don't set that structure in place, then you're going to be mad and you're going to mess up. You know, what happens is you're going to eventually blow and you interfere with your relationship and you don't want to do that. So, yeah. So definitely as adults, there are certain things that we. That we need to have happen to protect, to teach our children, to protect our relationships with them, and so forth. And so it's fine to be, it's not controlling to set the rules of the world, because we all have rules of the world. We all live by the rules of the world all the time. Just all kinds of things we can't do that we like to do, right? Yeah.
There are many people here with high school teenagers who may not be patient to go through these processes because of the nature of being a teenager and being impatient and not wanting to participate in any kind of process to get from A to B to C to D. And so how do you envision enhancing communication under those conditions?
Well, I think, you know, I have two of those myself. I think that if they really, I mean, there's nothing more compelling than being heard, you know, even to a 16-year-old, you know, like, okay, I really want to hear your opinion about the curfew, and I really do. I understand that you feel you should have a curfew. So let's talk. Let's sit down and talk about that. If they really think that that's going to go nowhere, I mean, if it really is going to go nowhere, then probably not. You know, they don't want to do it. I mean, you can still give them reasons why they have their curfew, but it is pretty compelling to be heard and to voice your opinion, for somebody to sit there and listen to you. But no, I mean, I hear you. I think it is challenging.
Well, the bigger issues, there's often more time that we do converse about things.
Yeah.
But the task-oriented things, there's less time.
Right.
And they're more time sensitive, like the trash is going to come out tomorrow. So
I hear you.
To go through all that process just to get them to take the trash out tomorrow versus the bigger, more consequential issues, which we do really go through all of that process.
Well, two thoughts I had. Now, it's a great point. Two thoughts I had. One is that that autonomy support takes more time than controlling this.
Sure.
There's no doubt about it. But I mean, if you think about where you want to put your time, do you really care if he takes the trash out? I mean, maybe you do, at the moment. But really, what you want to really care about is building responsibility. And you can't build responsibility by telling people what to do all the time. So, I mean, if you take a step back and you say, what am I really up to here? Do I really, cleaning things is hard for me because I'm a really messy person, so I truly don't care. So I struggle with that with my kids all the time. They know I don't. They're like, you don't care. And I know that. But if you do care about building that in them, then the only way that you're going to get them to really feel responsible for what you really care about is that they give to your home and they feel a sense of ownership about the things that happen around the house. And so when you have a moment to take the step back to go through that and get them on board with it, you know, is really the long term goal. Now, I'm not saying that in the short term we do all kinds of things in the short term, because truly what all we care about is making sure that they do X or Y, and so fine, just tell them what to do. But if they will do it at the moment. I mean, I'm not saying that that's a bad thing. I'm just saying that if we're trying to build our values, that we're just not going to get there by telling them, you know, yelling at them or telling them what to do all the time. You'll get extrinsic motivation of the gun to the head kind, but you can't get where where you really want to go. That's it. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah. Well, these are great questions. These are just great questions. I mean, great thoughts, too. So, yeah, along with the structure and along with the autonomy support goes the involvement. I'm really not a fan at all of the term helicopter parents, because people call me and they ask me to do stories on helicopter. I'm doing a story on helicopter parents. Would you, comment on it? Because you're in study controlling parents. And I say, no, that's just a bad word. I mean, it's parents who are really, it's a word for parents who are really involved with their kids. I mean, there's certainly a way in which, particularly if your kids get older, that you need to be involved in a way that supports their autonomy. But the fact that you talk to your child who's at college every day, it's just neither here nor there. I mean, if they want to talk to you and it supports their autonomy and you're really close, more power to you. You know, I don't think we should bash parents for wanting to be connected to their kids. And so
they call them Black Hawk Down parents. Really?
Yes.
Yeah, I like that.
Oh, geez. Oh, that's awful.
And say
the
word again?
They call them Black Hawk Down, which is just more intense.
Yeah. I wrote an op-ed not too long ago about parent bashing. I think we're in this like parent bashing place. We'd love to win support, but a parent in the media does something bad, we're loving it. When David Archuleta's dad was, what was he doing? He was
hanging lyrics behind stage or something awful. Yeah.
He was there. I don't know, it's his kid. I think that kid was like 17 or something, 16. I don't know. Anyway, the media just jumped on him. Oh, he's a controlling stage dad, and blah blah blah. And it turns out it's his son said he's just there because I wanted to be there. And I don't know. We're just in this interesting place around. Yeah. Oh, did you have a?
Well, I was going to address the dilemma when your kids are in high school about how much your involvement can be perceived by the school, faculty, and administration as hindering the autonomous development of your kid, where on some level, that's the last phase and stage you'll have to be sort of on duty, and then the next stage is where you sort of will have them outside of your purview. So I'm sometimes concerned that the boundary line for parent involvement, participation is a little, even in middle school where they, especially if they have any a learning issue or whatever, where they have to develop their own advocacy for themselves, where they're displacing onto children negotiations that the adults can't often do, and then wanting you to sort of have the kids have ownership but not keep you in a partnership.
Yeah. That's very interesting, and it can be easier for schools that way, or sometimes I don't know. But I mean, the partnership between families and schools is just it's so crucial. And at the high school, the evidence for the parent involvement in kids' schooling is right up through high school. And it's not in college, it's not in STEM studies. But it's right through, being involved, knowing what's going on, it's right through. But it has to, again, it can be perceived as intrusive by kids, and that's probably because it's not supporting autonomy.
I think it's perceived by the
school sometimes. Right. I see. Yeah, yes. No, that's it.
I wonder if the school has ever looked at that research. Because we do. We started elementary school allowing parent involvement, and then by, sixth grade, and then no more parent-teacher conferences.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's just or limited. So right. I wonder if schools actually ever look at that.
Yeah, it's just like this. It's a little bit of this myth of independence.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. And we don't in the literature. We don't buy it anymore. We don't think that kids become autonomous by separating from their parents and disconnecting from them. That doesn't make anybody happy. It doesn't make the kids happy. It doesn't make the kids more autonomous, because autonomy is about feeling ownership of your actions, and when you're doing things against your parents, you're not owning your actions. You're doing it, you're just reacting. That's not autonomy. So we have this sort of myth that kids are supposed to be independent of their parents. There isn't any evidence for that way. But somehow it's in our culture.
Right.
And
I do think adolescence, teenage, high school. I think that's the time where it should be more connected.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, not invasive, but at least connected somehow.
And what I found too is, you know, sometimes, you know, your child will say, you don't know what you're talking about, you know, you say, well, why don't, you know, have you thought about this or have you thought about that, and you don't know what you're talking about. I think on the phone with their mm-hmm. friend saying, well, we didn't try this, and they're saying exactly what you said.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
oh, yeah.
So you don't, your influence is just as strong, you know. But I think that's really true. We've set our schools up that way. So not, yeah. To the detriment of learning, I think. Yeah. So same kinds of things with the involvement, following rather than leading, tuning into their interests, making yourself available, but not necessarily leading, and of course, all of this is, there's always a time that we can't be autonomy supportive, and we just have to, you know, if your child's, you know, being hurt or being bullied or something like that, there are times to just step right in. Okay, next slide. So, I guess, if you can hang in there for a little while longer, and we can do some more discussing, or I can chat with you guys anytime, but I just had some challenges, so, right. It's all well and good to say, yes, I'm not gonna get anxious, and I'm gonna allow autonomy and this, that, but it keys you up inside to be worried and to be pressured and all, and you know, and the kinds of things, it's stress, so the kinds of things that decrease stress, like deep breathing and exercise and making sure you get some fresh air when these things come up, make it easier, right? And you know, since I started talking to friends about this stuff, you know, it's you know, you can really laugh at some of the things too. You know, say how crazy does this sound? I'm worried that, you know, I'm checking my child's swim times on the computer like 12 times to see if they changed since yesterday. How stupid am I? You know, that kind of thing. How you know, just sharing that, because they'll tell you a story too about what their worry is, and then you're laughing. You know, so you're not alone in this. You're not alone in this. In your concerns. This other one, it's again, it's the way our minds work when we see threat. It's we jump to the worst possible scenario. So you say, for example, you know, my child got a C in social studies. Well, they're gonna never get into the honors classes. Then they're gonna get to AP classes. Then they're gonna get to college. Then they're gonna, you know, be in a college where they meet another kid who's never got anything but a C in social studies, and children with C's in social studies. And you realize, oh my God. So you know, being able to talk back to yourself that way. Again, you know, this stuff is so visceral, but you can bring your cortex, gathering evidence, you know, that, you know, talking to your friends, oh, my kid got to see it. Social studies, now he loves social studies, he's great in it, you know, who knew? That kind of thing. Things really, really change. The most the shyest kid in kindergarten is the most outgoing kid in high school. Athletic ability in younger kids is really virtually uncorrelated with the later kinds of skills you need to be a great player. You know, it's just things change. And hardship builds strengths. You know, we I tell the story in the book of a year that my daughter had a very unfortunate teacher, and she only taught for a year, and she was long gone from the teaching profession, but she didn't know what the kids had done last year. She was teaching like last, you know, stuff from 2 years ago. And oh, I went in to see her and, you know, said, I think they did that last year. You know, she's not feeling challenged. I wonder, you know, what that, can I be helpful or whatever? And it didn't go anywhere. Anyway, and all the other grades were, all the other teachers were doing these fabulous things. They were all doing these great plays and everything and doing these big projects, and her teacher's doing them. And so she came home one day and she said, you know, we're not doing any of those, everybody's doing play. And she said, you know, maybe I can make my own play. So she actually made a play, which took me 1,000 hours to write with her because she was incapable of me. But we together, we wrote a play. She directed the play. Anyway, you know, it was the best year for her leadership skills that you could ever have. I mean, I think really she made a drastic turnaround in terms of like learning the idea that if things don't go your way, you've got to make them happen. Mm-hmm. And it was such a growth year. So you never know. You just never know what this terrible thing that happened. Not making a team for her, in her case, a particular team, but she was completely devastated about it. It was the best thing that ever happened to her, as it turned out. And the beauty of it was, as she completely decompensated, I was there. She was young enough. So what you want to do before your kids go off to college is be there for all the crises.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Right. They're just simply opportunities for you to teach your child something and to show them that the world does not end. Teenagers need to know that, terrible things happen, and then the world does not end. And you were there, and you didn't. Nobody. Just was okay. And so that you want those things to happen. Even if they never get that C. Then they won't get this. Then when they get to college and they get the C, and you're not there, who knows? So those bad things can be so great. If you just put it on its head, they're just opportunities. So when your child comes home with the C, you say, "This is a great. I'm so glad." No, this is a great opportunity. And then the thing we were talking about before, concentrating on a long-term goal. It's like you really don't care if your child cleans their room. It's the point is, what's the bigger picture? What are you really trying to do? What's the real thing you're trying to teach them, and how can you do that in an autonomy supportive way so that it teaches what you really want? So I think we get into trouble with controlling stuff is when we're focusing on the short term things. Like it's mm-hmm. crucial that at this moment this child learns the best way they can learn from their fourth grade teacher. But that really isn't in the long run. She caught up. It was fine. But at the moment, it did seem completely dire. people do fan flames. They're just around you saying things that make you anxious because they're anxious. And it helps them to tell you all the things they're doing and how great their kids' swim times are and where they're going to college and all. It helps them, but it doesn't mean anything for you. It doesn't mean you have to do anything. It doesn't. Nothing else works, stay away from them. they're not helping you at all. But just because they're doing all those things, you in your heart, you have faith that your child's going to follow their interests. And, I guess I think of it, that way a lot. It's just like having faith in intrinsic motivation. And it's hard to come by sometimes. It's hard for me to come by sometimes. It's like your world way. Sometimes it's hard because you don't see the short, getting kids to do things in the short term is quick. But the long term things that you're trying to build as you build autonomy take a while sometimes to come to be. So keeping that faith, I think, is and that's what we really try to do in the book by giving a lot of research to say, okay, truly, this has been shown, and we have done the research to back up the kinds of things that that we're saying, so that.
I thought the most compelling thing in your book was your discussions about the amygdala, the reptilian brain, and you didn't really produce much on that here, but it was so telling to really make me feel like it's not me, it's that part of my brain that is trying to survive like, 10,000 years ago. So that gave me a break in not blaming myself for any of the excesses that I made.
If I should stress that more. Do you like that? Oh, I'm glad you like that. But yeah.
I often have talked to my mother, raised 5 kids, and wasn't terribly involved in our lives. But yeah, and so she finds us fascinating today. That
we're doing this great social experiment, right?
And, you know, and she always says, you turned out fine. I mean, like, these, we were all raised in the 60s and 70s, and our parents, right or wrong, didn't look as though they didn't feel they were the gatekeepers to our success. And yet, many people living in this town have been successful in many different ways. And that's what keeps me up, and I try to remind, and it's gotten better as my kids have gotten older, but I really thought like it was up to me that I was going to be the motivating fact, that either I was going to set it up and play or it couldn't happen. And I read something not long ago in the Times, and I thought it was so awesome. And I try to remind myself, they said, think of the most well-balanced adult you know, not the most successful. And think about their parents, if you knew them. Their parents do everything for them, fight every battle, and breathe down their neck all the time. And they probably didn't. They probably didn't. And that really what they did is they found a way to motivate themselves. Mm-hmm. Probably because of their parents.
Yeah.
But that's what you're saying, that you can't fear. But I do, when someone asked if you had a question about geography, I think there are parts of the country that are tough to live in. I think the Boston area, Northern Virginia, places where parents have been academically successful, professionally successful, then we all get in these towns.
Right.
Sometimes I feed them. I lived in Montana. Where
then they all move to the same, and then they feed off. Yeah, right, sure.
No, you know, in this town, not only did the mothers went to MIT. I mean, it's really amazing sometimes. I think in the parent directories, they should say what we all did before. You know, it's really interesting. So it's kind of like our game was a little.
Yeah.
Very. And you're a professor. I mean, you're a professor in college. It's a pretty big job, and you obviously did well in school. And yet, we don't always share with our kids what we did. And
those are great.
But you must see with your students. Like, do you ever get to know your students?
Oh, sure.
And some of them probably had.
Oh, they love to tell stories about their parents.
But some of their parents are probably horrific, and they turned up.
Then your children won't tell you.
No, but it must be interesting with working in college students.
There are a couple of things in what you said. One is, you know, we are doing it different. There's no doubt about this generation of parents is doing it different, and I see it as a social experiment to see where it's going to go. You know, I think kids are pretty resilient. I think parents that show that they love. That they love their children and care about them. And that's really the most important thing. And whether you do it in a way that, you know, involved in one way versus another way, you know, that's the most important. That's certainly the most important thing. But yeah, I mean, I guess this level of involvement that we have, even if it's autonomy supported, it's interesting to see. And I can, yeah, I know personally, I had very little. And right, I sort of, pull myself up from my bootstraps kind of thing, and you wouldn't ever say, oh, gee, that's what you should do. I mean, because you can't count on that working. You're much more likely to count on a loving, involved parent having it, you know, create whatever, you know. But it's a bit of an experiment. In this theory, you can't create a love of something. You can't create a love of learning. You can't create, you know, you can't create a passion for a sport. You can nurture what's there, you know. Yeah, so.
Well, in that case, how do you motivate a child who is struggling at something? Like a class in school that they don't match well with the teacher, they're feeling failure. Other way, everything else is motivated except for this, and they just aren't interested. How do you get them to be involved again?
Yeah. Well, I guess you provide as much structure, autonomy, support, and involvement as you can around that issue, helping
them
to.
Controlling them.
Well, a lot of structure, a lot of breaking it down, being clear about what needs to be done, you know, that kind of stuff, a lot of empathy around, lots of positive feedback for small steps and things like that. I don't think it's real different for
just smaller chunks.
Yeah.
But the big thing is problem solving, because it's not a perfect world. So, what can you do about it? Mm. It's right now. It's,
the answer is nothing.
Nothing. Well, then if she's okay with that, if you're okay with that.
No.
I think that's some of the bigger.
Well, those are situations where we do get caught in the cycles of control.
Yeah. Right?
He doesn't want to do it. So you say you have to do it. You say, I'm going to stand here until you do it. And it just gets, so if you can get out of that.
Yeah.
If you can get out of that pattern by saying, whoa, let's step back here. This is not working. You know, let's talk about how should we do this so that, you know, because you know this homework's got to get done, and I know this homework's got to get done. How can we do this in a way that we're not fighting with each other? And, you know, what ideas do you have? And, you know, if there's a little buy-in at least to that. Because, I mean, I guess you could say, well, let's not do it at all. And you say, oh. That would be the best idea from your point of view. But we can't do that, so let's think about it. You know, so in a time where, I mean, there was a study done about homework where like 40% of children within like a month period cried at one point during homework. You know, homework is really emotional. Yeah. So if you're good, somebody's cries at home, you're not the only one. Everybody else's kid is crying too. So really, like, it's so easy. But in that, we do get more, the more trouble our kids are having with things, the less confident they are, so the more control they get. And so we need to, you know, that. So it's just a really easy trap to get into to make it worse. Yeah, I wish I had a magic bullet for that one.